الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء المرسلين مولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، this one is slightly lower because it cramps my style, the little that I have. The land of Iraq is the land which is in the headlines on a daily basis, because it is a land where Muslim blood flows like the Tigris and the Euphrates River. It is a land where blood is cheaper than oil, and the reality is that oil can be substituted for blood. But this is not the first time that Iraq has seen a massacre, for Iraq has a history of massacres. In 1258, when the Mongols took over Iraq under Hilubu, who was the grandson of Genghis Khan, the entire population of Baghdad at that time was 1.6 million. 1.6 million. And later historians write that half of the population of Baghdad was massacred. Can you imagine a group of people coming into Birmingham and killing half of the population? The massacres went on for such a long period that the rivers around Baghdad turned red with the blood of the Muslims. And then they ransacked the libraries, and Baghdad was one of the learning centers of the world. And then the same river which had turned red with the blood of the Muslims now turned black with the ink from the books. 1.6 million was the total in the population of Baghdad, and half of it was killed. And the narrations mention that they began to make pyramids with the skulls of the Muslims. And Ibn Athir, rahmatullah alayhi, the famous historian, mentions that for months I have been wanting to write about the atrocities which took place in Baghdad, but when I recall these atrocities, I cannot bring pen to paper. I cannot bring pen to paper. A muarrikh, a muhaddith like Ibn Athir rahmatullah alayh was traumatized by what he had seen in Baghdad. But this wasn't the first time that Iraq had seen a massacre. For centuries before this, Iraq saw another massacre, and in this massacre the rivers didn't turn red with the believers' blood, but the blood which ran through their veins was the holiest of blood, for it was the same blood which flowed through the veins of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this was the massacre of the blessed family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was the murder of that person who was the most beloved person to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam walking on the face of this earth. It was his grandson Hussein radiallahu anhu. For who other than Hussein had the honor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam putting him upon his shoulders? Upon occasion, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu saw Hassan and Hussein upon the shoulders of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Umar radiallahu anhu said, "Oh, what a beautiful ride you have." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "No, Umar, what beautiful riders I have upon my shoulders." Upon occasion, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was giving the Jummah khutbah, and Hassan and Hussein radiallahu anhu entered the masjid, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam descended from the pulpit. He picked Hassan and Hussein up, and then he ascended the pulpit again, and he said, "Indeed Allah speaks the truth when he says, Inna ma amwalakum wa auladukum fitna, that your wealth and your progenies are a fitna for you." Who else other than Hussein has the honor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam chasing in the streets of Medina? Upon occasion, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was walking through the streets of Medina, and he saw Hussein radiallahu anhu playing with a group of children, and he began to run after him. And Hussein would run this way, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would run after him. Hussein would run out that way, and Rahmatul Alameen sallallahu alaihi wasallam would run after him, until finally he caught him, he embraced him, and he kissed him. Who else other than Hussein had the honor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lifting his garment and kissing him upon his navel? Who else other than Hussein radiallahu anhu had the honor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, "Hussein is from me and I am from Hussein"? Who else other than Hassan and Hussein had the honor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that your house will be opposite my house in Jannah? Who else other than Hassan and Hussein had the honor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that on the day of judgment, in the hereafter, Sayyid al-Shabab Ahl al-Jannah, that you will be the leaders of all the youth in Jannah? All the youth in Jannah. And the amazing thing is that a group of people who regarded themselves as Muslims, after seeing how much love the Prophet ﷺ had for Hassan and Hussein, killed Hassan and Hussein. These people will come on the Day of Judgment and they will want the Prophet ﷺ to give him water on the well of Kawthar, but they deprive the grandson of the Prophet ﷺ for water for 3 days. They will come and they will want the Prophet ﷺ to intercede on their behalf, but they mercilessly killed that person who was the most beloved person walking on the face of this earth to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These people will come on the Day of Judgment and they will want the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to intercede upon their behalf. Moving on to the death of Hussein radiallahu anhu, the reality is, we use the word death, but these people don't die. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٍ بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَقُونَ. Do not think of those who have died fighting in the path of the Lord that they are dead. They are alive by Allah. They are alive by Allah. They are alive in our hearts. They are alive and kicking in the books of history. And the reality is that when these people die, they bring the ummah to life. When you recall their sacrifices for their deed, it brings our hearts to life. And therefore, we feel sorry for them. But Allah says, do not regard them as dead. They are alive in the Rabbihim yurzaqoon. And Allah sustains them. Allah sustains them. The background to the martyrdom of Hussein radiallahu anhu was that when Muawiyah radiallahu anhu passed away, he made his son Yazid the Khalif. Many of the people of Iraq felt that Hussein should have been the next Khalifa. And they began to write letters. The narrations mention that they sent 12,000 letters to Hussein radiallahu anhu. That Hussein, come to us and we will give bayah to you. We will regard you as the Khalifa. What Hussein radiallahu anhu did is that he sent his cousin Muslim ibn Aqil to see what was happening in Kufa. When Muslim ibn Aqil left, he left with 2 guys. On the way, the first one passed away. And then the second one passed away. And Muslim ibn Aqil got a very bad feeling about his journey. And he wrote a letter to Hussein, saying, Hussein, I got a very bad feeling about the journey. But Hussein radiallahu anhu told him to carry on. When he reached Kufa, within a number of days, 32,000 people gave bayah on the hands of Muslim ibn Aqil for Hussein radiallahu anhu. And he wrote a letter to Hussein radiallahu anhu, who was in Makkah. He said, Hussein, come to Kufa, for the people's hearts are with you. At that time, the governor of Kufa was a man called Numan ibn Bashir, who was a very pious person. And the people said, oh Numan, what are you doing? Why don't you sort Muslim out? And Umar ibn Rashid didn't want to be tested through the family of the Prophet ﷺ. And he said, I'd rather be weak for the truth than be strong for falsehood. And Yazid, when he saw that Numan ibn Bashir had turned a blind eye, then he replaced him with a tyrant called Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. What Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad did, he entered Kufa with his face covered. And the people of Kufa were already waiting for Hussein radiallahu anhu. And they thought that this is Hussein radiallahu anhu because he had a small entourage with him. And they began to say, Assalamu alaikum, O grandson of the Prophet. Assalamu alaikum, grandson of the Prophet. And then Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad understood the seriousness of the situation and he went straight to the governor's palace, and then the people understood that this is that Hussein, this is somebody else. And the first thing he did, he sent scouts out to look for the gatherings of Hussein radiallahu anhu, Muslim ibn Aqil. And one of the slaves they found this gathering, and what he would do, he would sit there and he would see who would come and go, who would come and go. And then he would report back to Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. And one of the lead people who would come to this gathering was the Prophet Sulhani. He was the leader of his people. And Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad summoned him and he asked him, Hani, tell me where Muslim is. And Hani said, I don't know where Muslim is. I don't even know who Muslim is. And then he called the slave out. And then Hani understood, game over. And then he said, I swear by Allah, if Muslim ibn Aqil was under my foot, I will not reveal him to you. If he was under my foot, I will not reveal him to you. When Muslim ibn Aqil found out that Hani had been arrested, he marched on the governor's palace with 4,000 people. 4,000 men. And what Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad had done, he had gathered all the leaders of the tribe, and he told him, if you peel off your men, then I will remunerate you. You will be my sidekicks. You will be my cronies.